Good morning. It's Sunday, February the 19th. The 19th day of February, the 19th day of Black History Week, the 19th day of my celebration of the words of other Black leaders. One of my favorite Black leaders is suffered a stroke recently last year, I think in September, and he was also diagnosed with a brain tumor, but he's still around. He's still fighting a good fight. Reverend Jerimiah Wright is one of my most, most honored ministers of Christ. He's a warrior. He's always fought for those who needed the fight for. And I believe in the goodness of Jerimiah Wright. I believe that Barack Obama made a mistake when he was asked to back away from Jerimiah Wright, when Jerimiah Wright gave this sermon that I'm going to read right now. But now that former President Barack Obama is no longer president, maybe in his final days on this planet, he will be able to make grace with Reverend Jerimiah Wright and let Jerimiah Wright slip into our memory as one of the greatest biblical leaders that this world has ever known. I love Jerimiah Wright. I love this sermon that he gave that day called God in Government. And I'm going to read it today in his words, my voice. You know, because our Black history need not be a Black mystery. And most young people will have known this sermon. If they haven't known it, they should read it. And I love reading it aloud because it just moves me. It motivates me. It fills me up inside. And it's Sunday, and I think I need to be filled up inside this Sunday. So if you would ask the average Christian, Jerimiah Wright said that day, did Jesus cry? Almost every Christian would quote for you that John 11:35 verse, which most Bible students call the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. It is the verse you will remember that is found in the middle of the story about the death of Lazarus. The Lord Jesus' friend, Jesus loved Lazarus, his friend. Lazarus had died. Jesus was outside the village of Bethany. He had not yet reached the city limits, and Martha had met him, and he and Martha had talked. Martha was mad, and she let the Lord know that she was mad. Jesus had reassured her with words she did not understand. I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live again. And whosoever liveth and believeth shall never die. Jesus had reassured her. Martha didn't understand these words, but at least Jesus had calmed her down for just a little bit. She left Jesus there and went back to the house and called her sister Mary and told her privately, Jesus is here, and Mary, he is calling for you. And when Mary heard those words, she got up quickly and went to where Jesus was, just outside of Bethany. When those who were grieving with her saw her get up quickly and go out, they ran along with her. You'll find that story in John 11. They thought she was going to her brother's grave to grieve. When Jesus saw her crying and Jesus saw those who were trying to console her crying, Jesus started weeping. The text says he was greatly disturbed in spirit and he was deeply moved. He asked Mary and Martha, where have you laid him? And they said, Lord, come and see. And he cried, Jesus wept. You know, death will make you weep. When you lose someone that you love, you will weep. When you lose somebody that is close to you, the tears will come. I ain't telling you about nothing I read in a book somewhere. I'm telling you what I know from personal experience. I'm telling you what I studied in pastoral counseling. I'm telling you that I have lived for when the pain of death hits and the pain is deep. When the pain of death hits and the pain is personal, when the finality of death comes crashing in on you, and those words never again move from the region of possibility to the heart-wrenching realm of reality. That smile that made your day, never again will you see it. The laughter that lit up your world, never again will you hear it. The wisdom that anchored your soul, never again will you experience it in this life. When that happens to you, my beloved, you will weep. You will cry. Jesus wept. Jesus cried. And most Christians learn very early in their walk of faith that John 11, 35 verse, what does it say? Jesus wept. You know, that's the first Bible verse you memorize. You go around the table and have to say a Bible verse at dinner. What's your verse? Jesus wept. But guess what? Guess what? Tonight's text teaches us that that is not the only time that Jesus wept. On this day that we call Palm Sunday, when the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God and joyfully, just as we just read, for all the deeds of power that they had seen, on the Sunday that we call Palm Sunday, as Jesus rode on a coat, on the Sunday before Monday, Thursday, the Sunday before Good Friday, while some of the Pharisees in the crowd tried to stop the praise of the profession that was taking place on that Sunday before he was put to death on a cross, stretched between two thieves, the Sunday that he said, if these who are praising me hold their peace, then rocks will cry out. On the Sunday before he sealed our salvation, as he came near the city, the text we just read said, in the midst of praise, Luke tells us that he wept over the city. He cried for his people who did not know the things that make for peace. He cried for his people because they were blinded by their culture. They were blinded by their condition. They were blinded by their circumstance. They were blinded by their oppression. They were blinding by being in a spot where they desired, deeply desired revenge, and they could not see the things that make for peace. We keep forgetting. Yes, we keep forgetting, and we need to remember. Jerome Ross wrote about it like he reminded you of it. He write it down so you don't forget. These people had, in Luke 19, an occupying army living in their country. Jesus, in verse 33, comes, calls them their enemies, says enemies. Their enemies had all the political power. Remember, they had to send Jesus to a court presided over by the enemy. A provisional governor appointed by their enemies ran the civic and the political affairs of the capital. He had backing him up a occupying army with superior soldiers. They were commandos trained in urban combat and trained to kill on command. Remember, it was the soldiers of the 3rd Marine Regiment of Rome who had fun with Jesus, who was mistreated as a prisoner of war, an enemy of the occupying army stationed in Jerusalem to ensure mopping up the action of the operation. It's really freedom. These people were blinded by the culture of war. Do you know what it's like to live under military rule? 24/7, 365. These people were blinded by circumstances of oppression. Their enemies not only had all the political power with Governor Pontius Pilate, you all call him Pontius Pilate. He's Italian, Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate was running the provisional government. Their enemies also had the military power. They not only had political power, they had military power. It was the Roman soldiers who kept Jesus up all night. It was the Italian army who led Jesus out to Calvary on Friday morning. It was the occupying military brigade that forced Simon of Cyrene to carry the cross for Jesus. These people were tired of their oppression. They wanted the enemy out of their land. Some of them did, some of them didn't. Not the businessmen, not those in bed with the enemy. Let's be clear. Let's really be clear. But the average citizen wanted them out, but they also wanted revenge. They wanted their king to get this military monkey off their back. They wanted a regimen change, if you will, a regime change. And they looked, and what they called Jesus looked at it in verse 31. They called Jesus the king. Look at verse 31. They called him the king. Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. They wanted their king. See, they see their king. They saw God, the Lord, getting ready to do something about this situation. Blinded by the pain of their situation, they could not see the things that made for peace, you all. So Jesus cried, "Let me help you with something. Let me help you. Let me help you." The military does not make for peace. The military only keeps a lid on for a little while. The military doesn't make for peace, and the absence of armed resistance doesn't mean the presence of genuine peace. Somebody needs to hear me tonight. You're not hearing me. War does not make for peace. We said at the 11 o'clock service, fighting for peace is like raping for virginity. War does not make for peace. War only makes for escalating violence and a mindset to pay the enemy back by any means necessary. When your wife or your children have been crushed by the enemy, when your father or your mother have been mowed down by the military, peace is not on your mind. Payback is the only game in town. You see, you bide your time and wait for the opportunity, but somebody is going to pay dearly for the permanent damage that has come into your life and wrecked your world and as well as rocked your world. You see, the military does not make for peace. War does not make for peace. Occupying somebody else's country does not make for peace. Killing those that fought to protect their own homes does not make for peace. Press conferences claiming victory do not make for peace. Regime change, substituting one tyrant for another tyrant, with the biggest tyrant pulling the puppet strings of all the tyrants, that does not make for peace. Colonizing a country does not make for peace. If you don't believe me, look at Haiti. Look at Puerto Rico, look at Angola, look in Zimbabwe, look at Kenya, look at the Ashtar Boys in South Africa. Colonization does not make for peace. Occupation does not make for peace, and subjugation only makes for temporary silence. It does not make for peace. These people who wanted a new king were blinded by their circumstances. It made Jesus cry because they missed the meaning of his ministry. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, "Miss the meaning of his ministry." You see, when Jesus says, "You did not recognize the time of your visitation from God," down in verse 44, Jesus is saying, you did not recognize the time of my ministry. You did not see the meaning of my ministry. You are missing the real things that make for peace. You are confusing external appearances with external power. You are looking at the man and you are not looking at what the man represents. You're looking at the miracle. That's verse 37. When the deeds of power they are praising, that's the miracle. Sight to the blind, deeds of power. Hearing to the deaf, deeds of power. Speech to the mute, deeds of power. Cleansing of the lepers, deeds of power. Wholeness to the broken, deeds of. You're looking at the miracles and missing the meaning behind the miracle. A miracle is just a sign. A sign only points to something or points the way to something. Don't get fixated on a sign and miss completely what the sign is pointing to. The deeds of power to God who are greater than any physical limitation, and a God who can overcome any limiting situation. The things that make for peace, only God can give those things. You're all looking for government for that and for government to give what only God can give. No wonder Jesus wept. He had good cause to cry. The people under oppression were confusing God and government. I want you to say to yourself and say to somebody aloud, confusing God and government. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to hang out here and homilificate for just a little while, and then I'm going to let you go home. I got to pause here, however, as a pastor, because a lot of people still confuse, 2,000 years later, they still confuse God with their government. Now, we can clearly see the confusion in the minds of a few Muslims, and please notice I did not say all Muslims. I said a few Muslims who see a law condoning killing and killing any and all who do not believe what they believe. They call it jihad. We can see clearly the confusion in their minds, but we cannot see clearly what it is that we do. We call it crusade when we turn right around and say our God condones the killing of innocent civilians as a necessary means to an end. They say that God understands collateral damage. We say that God knows how to forgive friendly fire. We say that God will bless the shock and awe as we take over unilaterally another country, calling it a coalition, because we got three guys from Australia going against the United Nations, going against the majority of Christians, Muslims, and Jews throughout the world, making a preemptive strike in the name of God. We cannot see what we are doing is the same as Al-Qaeda is doing under a different color flag, calling on the name of a different God to sanction and approve our murder and our mayhem. Let me tell you something this morning. Let me tell you something. Jesus said something about that too. Oh yes, he did. Jesus said, how can you see the speck in your brother's eye and not see the log in your own eye? Well, I submit to you that we can't see it first because we don't see nobody who don't like us, who don't look like us, dress like us, talk like us, worship like us as a brother, and Jesus calls them brother. We demonize them, and that makes it all right to kill them because our God is against demons. Then we can't see the speck most of all because we equate our government with our God. We confuse government and God. Let me tell you something. We believe in this country. We teach our children that God sent us to this promised land. He sent us to take this country from the Iroquois, the Susquehanna, the Apache, the Comanche, the Cherokee, the Seminole, the Choctaw, the Hopi, and the Arapaho. We confuse government and God. We believe God sanctioned the rape and robbery of an entire country, continent. We believe God ordained African slavery. We believe God makes Europeans superior to Africans and superior to everybody else too. We confuse God and government. We find that in our founding document as a government, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, created, which means God, and endowed with a certain inalienable right that means given by God. And then we define Africans in those same documents as 3/5 of a person. We believe God approved African slavery. We believe God approved segregation. We believe God approved apartheid. And a document says all men are created more equal than other men, and we're talking about white men. We confuse God and government. We believe that God approves of 6% of the people on this earth controlling all the resources on the face of this earth, while the other 94 live in poverty and squalor, while we give trillions of dollars of tax breaks to the white rich. We believe God was the founding member of the World Bank and International Monetary Fund. Look at the lily whiteness of the G7 nations the next time you see a picture, and tell me if you see anything wrong with that picture. When you hold it up against the picture of the color of the world's population, we confuse God and government. We believe God is on the side of the wealthy. We believe it is all right to send our military to fight, and if necessary, to die in Iraq and anywhere else we decide is part of the axis of evil, while George W. cuts the military benefits so that when these boys and girls come home, they can be as bad off as some of the Iraqis that we just liberated. We confuse God and government. We do. We believe, yes, we believe we have the right to Iraqi oil. We believe our current president, Donald Trump, believes we have the right to Iraqi oil. We believe that we have the right to Venezuelan oil. We believe that we got the right to all the oil on the face of the earth, and we've got the military to take it if necessary. Or as George W. Posley says, as God so leads him. We confuse God and government. We believe that it's all right to disseminate the Afro-Colombian community by arming the paramilitary with the United States tax dollars, our dollars, by hiring military whose real job is to protect paramilitary with the United States tax dollars, our dollars, by hiring military whose real job is to protect the oil line owned by the United States companies tied to the president, which was stolen by the oil interests. We're confusing God and government, and it gets worse. It truly gets worse. We got a paranoid group of patriots in power now that, in the interest of homeland security, they're taking away the constitutional right of free speech because it's harmful to the interests of national security, and those interests equate God with government. Our money says in God we trust, and our military says we will kill under the orders of our commander in chief if you dare believe otherwise. We are still confusing God and government in the year of 2003, just like it was confused in Luke 19. Well, in this case, you are in that great number, and I understand from the polls that the number has gone up. Still confused. If you are in that number of confused folks 2,000 years after Christ, let me share 3 quick things with you to help clear up your confusion. Turn to your neighbor and say, listen, we got to say it right. Say it with attitude and with ebonics. Say it, he fitting to help somebody tonight. Turn to the other side and say, we fitting to. Government's number one. Governments lie. The government lied about their belief that all men were created equal. The truth was that they believed all white men were created equal. The truth is that they did not believe that even white women were created equal in creation nor in civilization. Government had to pass an amendment to the Constitution to get white women the vote. Then the government had to pass an equal rights amendment to get equal protection under the law for women. The government still thinks a woman has no right over her body. And between Uncle Clarence, who sexually harassed Anita Hill, in the closeted clam court that is a throwback to the 19th century, handpicked by Daddy Bush, Ronald Reagan, and Gerald Ford, hung between Clarence and that stacked court, they're about to undo Roe versus Wade, just like they're about to undo affirmative action. Governments lied in its founding documents, and the government is still lying today. You see, governments lie. Turn to your neighbor and just say this: governments lie. Governments lied about Pearl Harbor. They knew the Japanese were going to attack. Governments lie. Governments lied about the Gulf of Tonkin. They wanted their resolution to get into the Vietnam War. Governments lie. The government lied about Nelson Mandela and how CIA helped put him in prison and kept Nelson there for 27 years. The South American government lied on Nelson Mandela. Governments lie. Turn to your neighbor and say this again: governments lie. The government lied about the Tuskegee experiment. They purposely infected African American men with syphilis. Governments lie. The governments lied about bombing Cambodia. And Richard Nixon stood in front of the camera and said, "Let me make myself perfectly clear, we are not a government lie." The government lied about drugs for armed contra schemes orchestrated by Oliver North, and then they pardoned, the government pardoned all the perpetrators so that they could get better jobs in the government. Governments lie. The government lied about inventing the HIV virus as a means of genocide against people of color. Governments lie. Government lied about the connection between Al-Qaeda and Saddam Hussein and a connection between 9/11 and the Operation Iraqi Freedom. Governments lie. The government lied about weapons of mass destruction in Iraq being a threat to the United States peace. And guess what else? They don't find them some weapons of mass destruction. They're going to do just like the LAPD and plant them some weapons of mass destruction. You see, governments lie. But I'm fitting to help you. I'm fitting to turn to your neighbor and say, I just want you to say to your neighbor right now, he fitting to help us. Reverend Jerimiah Wright is fitting to help us. When governments lie, where governments lie, God does not lie. Read Numbers 23:19. It says, God is not man that he should lie. That's the King James translation. The New Revised Translation says, repeat it after me so that you won't forget it. God is not a human being that he should lie. I want you to say that again. God is not a human being that he should lie. Say it together. God is not a human being that he should lie. Where governments lie, God does not lie. That's number one. Number two, governments change. Long before there was a red and white and blue colonization, the Egyptian government was doing colonization. They colonized half the continent of Africa. They colonized parts of the Mediterranean. All colonizers were white. Turn to your neighbor and say, oppressors come in all colors. Hello? Hello, hello. But when the government of Egypt and the Pharaoh ran it, they don't run a thing today. And why? Because governments change. When the Babylonians carried away the people of promise into exile, the Babylonian government was the baddest government around. But when the king, Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar went crazy. His government was placed by the government of King Belshazzar. And King Belshazzar held a great big feast, big banquet, defiled the sacred vessel stolen from the temple in Jerusalem, and a hand appeared out of nowhere and started writing on the wall, "Mene, mene, tako, pasen." And Daniel translated the writing for the king and told him, "Here's what it means, king." You can find it in Daniel 5. "Mene, God has numbered the days of your government and brought it to an end." Government change. Tinkle. "You have been weighed on the scales of justice, and you are too light to balance the scales." Parson, that's from the verb Perses. "Your kingdom, your government is divided and now given to Medes and to the Persians." And the Bible said that night, that very same night, King Belshazzar was killed and Darius the Mede took over the government. You see, governments change, you all. Darius was replaced later on by another government. And then another 70 years later, King Cyrus said to the people of promise, "You all can go back home. All I'm trying to do is to get you to see that governments change." Prior to Abraham Lincoln, the government in this country said it was legal to hold African slaves in slavery and in perpetuity. Perpetuity is one of those University of Chicago words. You know what it means? It means forever, from now on. When Lincoln got in the office, the government changed. Prior to the passing of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments to the Constitution, the government defined Africans as slaves, as property. Yeah, I said property. People with no rights to be respected by any whites anywhere. The Supreme Court of the government, the same court, the granddaddy court of the one that stole in 2000 presidential election, the Supreme Court said in the Dred Scott decision in the 1950s, no African anywhere in this country has any rights that any white person has to respect at any place, any time. That was the government's official position, backed up by the Supreme Court. That's the judiciary, backed up by the executive branch. That's the president, backed up by the legislative branch, enforced by the military of the government. But I stopped to tell you tonight, the governments change. Prior to Harry Truman's government, the military in this country was segregated, but governments changed. Prior to the Civil Rights and Equal Accommodations Law of this country, of this government in this country, there was black segregation by the country. Legal discrimination by the government prohibited blacks from voting by the government. You had to eat in separate places by the government. You had to sit in different places from white folks because the government says so, and you had to be buried in a separate cemetery. It was apartheid American style, from cradle to grave, all because the government backed it up. But guess what? Governments changed. Under Bill Clinton, we got that messed up welfare to work bill, but under Clinton, blacks had an intelligent friend in the Oval Office. Oh, but governments changed. The election was stolen. We went from an intelligent friend to a dumb Dixiecrat, a rich Republican who had never held a job in his life. Is against affirmative action, against education, against health care, against the benefits for his own military, and gives tax breaks to the wealthiest contributors to his campaign. Governments change, sometimes for the good and sometimes for the bad. But I'm fitting to help you again. I want you to turn back and say that Reverend Wright is fixing to help us now. He's fixing to help us again. When governments change, write this down. Malachi 3:6, "Thus saith the Lord," repeat after me, "for I am the Lord and I change not." That's the King James Version. The New Revised say, "For I, the Lord, do not change." In other words, Where governments change, God does not change. God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. That's what his name is. That's why his name is I Am. It means you know. He does not change. There is no shadow of turning into God. One songwriter put it this way, as thou have been, thou forever will be. Thou changest not, thou compassions, they fail not. Great is thy faithfulness, God, Lord, unto me. God does not change. God was against slavery on yesterday, and God does not change. It's still against slavery today. God was a God of love yesterday, and God who does not change is the God of love today. God was a God of justice on yesterday, and God does not change. God is still a God of justice today. I want you to turn to your neighbor, because I want you to tell them that God does not change. Where governments lie, God does not lie. Where governments change, God does not change. And I'm through now, but I want to leave you with one more thing. Governments fail. The government in this text comprised of Caesar, Cornelius, Pontius Pilate. The Roman government failed. The British government used to rule from east to west. The British government had a Union Jack. She colonized Kenya, Ghana, Nigeria, Jamaica, Barbados, Trinidad, and Hong Kong. Her navies ruled the seven seas all the way down to the tip of Argentina and the Falklands. But the British failed. The Russian government failed. The Japanese government failed. The German government failed, and the United States government, when it came to treating citizens of Indian descent fairly, she failed. She put them on reservations. And when it came to treating the citizens of Japanese descent fairly, she failed. She put them in internment prison camps. When it came to treating her citizens of African descent fairly, America failed. She put them in chains. The government put them in slave quarters, put them on the auction blocks, put them in cotton fields, put them in inferior schools, put them in substandard housing, put them in scientific experiments, put them in the lowest paying jobs, put them outside the equal protection of law, kept them out of their racist bastions of higher education, and locked them into positions of hopelessness and helplessness. The government gives them the drugs, builds bigger prisons, passes a three-strike law, and then wants us to sing, God bless America. Oh, no, 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 no. God bless America. God damn America. That's in the Bible for killing innocent people. God damn America for treating her citizens as less than human. God damn America, as long as she keeps trying to act like she is God and she is supreme. The United States government has failed the vast majority of her citizens of African descent. Think about this, and really I want you to think about this. For every one Oprah, a billionaire, we got 5 million blacks who are out of work. For every one Colin Powell, a millionaire, we got 10 million blacks who cannot read. For every Condoleezza Rice, we got 1 million in prison. For every one Tiger Woods who needs to get beat at the Masters with his cat-blazing hips playing on a course that discriminates against women, God has a way of bringing you short when you get too big for your cat-blazing britches. For every one Tiger Woods, we got 10,000 black kids who will never see a golf course. The United States government has failed the vast majority of its citizens of African descent. But I'm fitting here, Reverend Wright. I'm fitting to help you one last time. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, Reverend Wright is fitting to help us one last time. Turn back and say, forgive him for the goddamn. That's in the Bible, Lord. Blessings and curses is in the Bible. It is the Bible, and I'm fitting to help you one last time. Let me tell you something. Where governments fail, God never fails. Where God says it's done, God never fails. When God wills it, you better get out of the way, because God never fails. When God fixes it, oh, believe me, it's fixed. God never fails. Somebody right now, you think you can't make it, but I want you to know that you are more than a conqueror through Christ. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. To the world, it looked like God has failed in God's plan of salvation. When the Savior was sent by God to put to death on a Friday afternoon, it looked like God failed. But hallelujah, on Sunday morning, the angels in heaven were singing, God never fails. You can't put down what God raises up. You see, God never fails. You can't keep down what God wants up. You see, God never fails. If God can get a three-day Jesus up out of a grave, what's going on in your life that in any way can't match what God has already done? He'll abide with you. He'll reside in you. He'll preside over your problems. And if you take them to him and leave them with him, don't take them back. Turn to your neighbor and say, stop taking your problems back. Should we always bring our problems to the altar? And then do we just them right there on our back and on our seats turn and say, just stop taking them back, you know, because God never fails. Just turn and tell everyone that you know today that God never fails. God never fails. My God never fails. And that was the goddamn America speech that, of course, at that time, Senator Barack Obama was a member of the church of Jerimiah Wright, attended regularly with his wife. But once this video got out of this speech, he was asked to backtrack and to denounce his minister, because his minister said what the Bible said. God damn America when America isn't doing right by its people. Thank you. Have a great Sunday, February the 19th. Look forward to the week, Black History Weekend. In his words, my voice, our Black history need not be a Black mystery. My Sunday sermon for today.